Hi guys, Dr. J here, and in this video, we're going to continue our discussion of weather and talk about air stability and instability. We've been talking about weather now in a couple of videos. I'll link to those in the notes to this video. And in this video, we're going to tie together a number of those concepts while we talk about air stability. And of course, air stability is important for flying because stable air and unstable air are going to have different implications for whether or not you'll be able to fly, the kind of weather that you'll expect. And you can see some examples of that here. You can always check out these extra study guide materials. I encourage you to do that, especially the PHAC, the Pilot's Handbook of Aeronautical Knowledge, really useful. And a lot of the images and things that I show in these videos are coming directly out of the PHAC. Really good resource for you there. And of course, the other resources are there as well. And again, just as a reminder, there's two different sort of aspects of the weather that you need to know as a Part 107 in order to take the Part 107 exam. The first is the actual information about the weather and how it impacts aircraft. That's what we're talking about in this video with air stability. And then the second part is where to get that information. And we'll talk about that in other videos when we talk about the ATIS and the METARs and all of that. Okay, but let's jump in. We're going to talk about air stability. And again, as I mentioned before, this is going to be kind of tying together and relating to several of the other topics that we've talked about. Now let's talk about air stability. And air stability is the tendency of air masses to resist vertical motion. Now, this is going to be a little bit of physics in this part of the video, but hang in there. You can handle it. This is going to be basically related to moisture in the air and temperature in the air. So moisture will be one key term. Temperature will be the other key term. Cool, dry air is going to tend to be stable. No moisture, no energy. Very little cool air means less energy. So that is going to tend to be stable. Warm and wet air is going to tend to be unstable. So high humidity, high temperature, think higher energy, unstable. Now, the definition of stability is going to be related to the so-called lapse rate of the air mass. And lapse rate is basically how quickly the air mass is able to cool or is cooling as it rises. So warm air is going to tend to rise. And how quickly it cools is going to be related to this adiabatic lapse rate, the rate of decrease of temperature experienced by a parcel of air when it is lifted in the atmosphere under the restriction that it cannot exchange heat with its environment. So that's a complicated definition, but what it basically means is how much the temperature is changing as it's rising. And what's going to happen is, as air is rising, as it's cooling, it's going to be condensing water vapor, right? Our humidity is going to be going down as the air is cooling because that water vapor, the temperature is getting lower, and so it can't hold all the water vapor. And that's going to release energy. And that release of energy is going to allow that air to continue rising. And how fast that happens is going to be related to the stability of the air. If it doesn't happen very fast, then it's going to be stable. If it happens very fast, it's going to be unstable. And stable air makes vertical development difficult. So if you have cool, dry air, you're not going to release you're not going to release energy when moisture is condensing because there's no moisture to condense. But unstable air is going to create turbulence. It's going to create convective activity, vertical air movement, and this is what can lead to thunderstorms in the most extreme case. So stable air is going to be characterized by stratiform clouds, layered clouds. Horizontally layered clouds mean there's no vertical motion, and so that's going to be more stable air. That's what we have today in Raleigh. Continuous precipitation. Stable air has kind of a rain all day kind of characteristic. So if it's raining, it's going to be probably not changing much throughout the day. Smooth air, so there's not going to be vertical motion, as we said. Fair to poor visibility. That's because if you have stable air, you can have things like fog. Most types of fog are happening when you don't have much air movement. And also you have rain, you might have cloudy skies, and so you're going to have fair to poor visibility. On the other hand, unstable air is going to be related to cumuliform clouds. So those cumuliform clouds, those beautiful puffy white clouds that we see on a nice summer's day, for example, are actually the beginning signs of unstable air, vertical air motion. This can be related to showery precipitation. So this is where a front is moving through and you get a rainstorm for a while and then it stops. So very short duration rain. Rough turbulent air because you have all this vertical air motion. And also tends to be good visibility. Why is that? This is that nice summer day kind of situation where you have vertical air motion, the air is moving around, so moisture is not able to just sort of stay in one place, and as a result, you get fairly good visibility. Now again, during a thunderstorm, obviously you would not have good visibility. So not all of these characteristics are necessarily going to be happening all at the same time. But these are the general characteristics of stable and unstable air. And these things will show up. These words will show up on the Part 107 exam. So make sure you understand these. As I mentioned, we've got these different types of cloud forms associated with different air conditions. So layered clouds are going to be related to stable air, whether those are high or low. Those are all going to be fairly stable air. Nimbus clouds are going to be related to stable air, nimbostratus, that means stable. But these cumulus clouds and then the cumulonimbus clouds are going to be related to unstable air, vertical air motion. Stratus clouds, horizontal growth, little to no vertical motion, stable air. Cumuliform clouds, that means vertical motion, that means unstable air. So let's talk about thunderstorms. Thunderstorms are the extreme version of vertical motion and unstable air. So for a thunderstorm to form, there are a few conditions that must be in place. The air must have sufficient water vapor. So if air is very dry, you won't get a thunderstorm, even if you have very warm air. You must have an unstable lapse rate. So as warm, moist air is getting lifted up, it's generating lots of energy as that moisture is condensing, and that's just driving this vertical motion, continues to rise up, continues to condense moisture. And so with an initial lifting action to start the process, you can generate these vertical air currents that result in cumulonimbus clouds. So cumulus clouds that continue to build and build and build throughout the whole entire troposphere. The rising and cooling of air that results in condensation results in what? It results in the production of heat from the vapor changing from the gas phase to the liquid phase. And I've got a little chart here to kind of illustrate this. As you go from vapor to liquid, you have a release of what is called latent heat into the environment. So this is basically energy that was in the vapor phase. Vapor has more energy than liquid, right? There's more energy in a gas than a liquid. You condense moisture that was in the air. You release energy into the environment, and that release of energy is what's driving these thunderstorms. So for these thunderstorms to start forming, we need an initial lifting action to start the process, and then that's going to be driving these vertical air motions, these vertical air currents. Here you have, so you might start out as beautiful cumulus clouds on a nice summer's day, but if this lifting action is allowed to continue, if it becomes very unstable, that's where you get these very, very large, very high cumulus clouds that produce thunderstorm clouds. And there are a couple different stages to this formation. So the cumulus stage, this is the stage I'm showing here, is maybe 3 to 5 mile high clouds. The mature stage is the full cumulonimbus clouds, where your clouds are actually reaching up all the way to the top of the troposphere and hitting the tropopause and spreading out. That's 5 to 10 mile height, again, all the way to the top of the troposphere. And then the dissipating stage after the storm, a little bit lower, but the clouds are still pretty high. And very much related to these thunderstorms and the initial lifting action, which we need to start this whole process, are fronts. So fronts are going to be two air masses with different characteristics, typically temperature, that collide together. And this is often how you're going to get that initial lifting action to start off a thunderstorm. But we'll talk about that here in a second. When we're crossing a front, the temperature is going to change and the wind direction is going to change. And this often results in a narrow line of thunderstorms along that front, because all along the front, you're going to have lifting motion, potentially, where you have warm air coming over cold air. That's a cold front. And that is going to get these thunderstorms, get this cumulonimbus cloud formation started. And so you'll have what is called a squall line. Now, fronts are always shown on weather charts in these ways. So we have a cold front with the triangles, and we have warm fronts with the red-colored circles. We have a stationary front, which, as the name suggests, is stationary or nearly so. And then we have an occluded front. And an occluded front is actually when one front overtakes another front. So a cold front overtakes a warm front. Cold fronts tend to move faster than warm fronts, and so they can overtake them, and then you have this occluded front. All of these fronts are going to potentially be associated with rain. Cold fronts are going to be associated with squall lines, thunderstorms, because you're lifting warm air over cold air. We'll talk about that in a second. Warm fronts are going to be more associated with steady rain conditions. Here's a diagram of a cold front. We have warm air that's moving up and over a cold air mass that is moving into the region. So the cold air is moving in. Cold air is more dense than the warm air, and so the warm air is going to be forced up and over it. And this is exactly where we get that lifting action, the initial lift force that we need to get our vertical air motion going and start our thunderstorm formation process. And so this is why cold fronts are often associated with thunderstorms, because you have this warm air rising that's cooling down, that's going to start precipitating, condensating moisture, and that's going to start this unstable lapse rate and start the whole process to thunderstorm formation. Now, we've also got warm fronts, and again, here's a diagram of what this might look like at different places. So warm air, again, rising over cold air, kind of pushing the cold air out of the way. We start out with our cirrus clouds up at the highest elevation, transitioning into cirrostratus and then altostratus, and then nimbostratus. So these are our rain clouds. And you'll notice that these clouds are indicative of stable air. So a warm front tends to be characterized by much more stable conditions than cold fronts. So warm fronts, cold fronts, there are also, as I mentioned, occluded fronts where you can have a cold front kind of intersect with a warm front. So that wraps it up for fronts. And in the next video, we will talk about looking at weather reports and how to interpret them and understand them and what they tell you about the weather.